Hi, this is Dave Miller. I'd like to welcome you to College Prep for You. This is our 10th program in this year's series of 16 programs we've designed to inform parents and families in the greater Monterey Bay Area about the college application and admissions process. Last year we started this program, we had 13 segments of it. We have 16 this year, and they're broken down into one-hour segments that basically teach the process and sort of investigate all the things that families and students will run into as they go through this sort of interesting, sometimes mysterious, and often confounding process of applying and gaining admissions to college. Today's program, we're going to talk about two things, two focuses. One, we're going to take advantage of this recent trip that Stevenson School took back east. We have two basic tours that we take to educate our students and get them on college campuses. One in the fall, we go to Southern California schools, and the one we just did over our winter break was a 9-day trip flying back east to Washington, working our way up the eastern seaboard, and ending up in Boston before flying home. 9 days we spent on lots of campuses, we saw alumni, we learned lots of things. We're going to sort of recap that for you and present some ideas for you so you can work that sort of thing into your scheme if you'd like to visit some campuses. The other major part that we want to take advantage of today is, and we've never talked about this before because we haven't really had access to the experts on the other side of the desk, but we want to find out what this process looks like from the person like me that sits on the college side of the desk. So we're going to probe some issues, and find out if we're really on the right mark here and doing the right things. And we're going to find out from what of our really reliable close affiliates here at Santa Clara University. A lot of our students at Stevenson go there. In fact, Santa Clara has been always in our top five. And I think it's a friend of most of the schools in the Monterey Peninsula, not just because it's a wonderful school, but because it's in the Jesuit tradition, and they're a surefire bet for college. So we're going to talk with a parent, a student, and then a representative of the school. In past programs, we've talked about a variety of issues that help delve into this process. Just as a recap or summary, we've talked about, well, first of all, we started with an overview of the year, looking at all the topics we're going to touch on. Next, we had a panel of four admissions officers and four students talking in our chapel to about 150, 200 students. They provided information. There was a Q&A session. We spent a session on the UC system and the Cal State system. We've talked about financial aid. We've talked about interviewing, getting good recommendations, the essay, all the different parts, the nuts and bolts of this process. In the future, we'll talk about athletics and recruiting. Our next show, which will be in 2 weeks, we'd like to invite you to take part of that, is basically for seniors, and it addresses the question, what do I do now once I've been accepted, denied, waitlisted, or deferred? Because that date, the magic date of April 1st, is coming up for our seniors, and that's the date where just about everybody will have learned what their predicament is, and we're going to give some advice there. We might have some seniors. We're going to talk about that as well. Then in subsequent weeks, we'll jump back to the junior side, like we've been on through the spring here, and basically talk about issues that affect the junior class. We're right in the middle of the junior process, so if you're a junior watching this program, or a sophomore, or any of those families, you're sort of right in tune with what you should be learning for this period of time. The seniors are pretty much done. We put them to bed. They're just sort of getting some closure on what they've done. Maricela here is going through the last applications at Santa Clara. They're going to be, they have been making their decisions. They're going to be sending out those decisions to seniors. So as we put the seniors to bed, we focus on the juniors, and we're lucky to have a junior here, and we're going to be able to comment both on the Santa Clara issue that we're going to present, and also on the tour that that our young junior took part in. So, without any further ado, let's meet our guests. First off, beauty before age, I guess, probably. We'll start with our a junior student at Stevenson, Elisa Anderson. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
So, I'm a junior this year at Stevenson, and I'm a member of Green Key, mm-hmm. which is where we give tours to prospective families around the campus. And also, I'm very involved in sports. I've been playing sports my whole life, and I'm captain of the field hockey team, and I also play soccer and lacrosse. And also this year, I decided to try something new. I'm trying digital photography, mm-hmm. which has been really fun, and I plan to take advanced photography next year. And it's fun to just try digital photography instead of the old film.
And you took some pictures on the trip then, right?
Yes, I did. I took
lots of pictures. So read my reminder. I sent you guys today a little note. Put them on a DVD, send them to me so I can mount those pictures.
I will. Yeah, right? Lots of pictures.
Okay, so you're active on campus. Do you have some leadership going on yet?
Next year, I hope to be a community forum leader, mm-hmm. which is where we go on the freshman trip at the beginning of the year, and you are kind of like a mentor to the freshman class okay. when you're a senior.
You think that's important?
I think it's very important just to have someone, not just a teacher, telling you about school and life in general, but to get to talk to seniors, because they're a kid just like you, experiencing the same okay. thing.
Maricela, let me just interrupt here. You read my letters, and you know what mm-hmm. Stevenson's like. Do you remember that, the senior forum component that we have? Do you remember me talking about those?
I do.
How does that affect somebody's application?
I think it just helps the application overall, because it adds the personal component to the application. As we know, Santa Clara doesn't evaluate applications just based on numbers. We also look at the personal, and we'll look at the involvement that students are the student involvement at their high school.
Okay, on the personal side, you know, you're a good kid, well scrubbed, keep your nose straight, clean. You're a leader, you're a green key person on campus, you lead mm-hmm. tour guides and things, two or three sports. Mm-hmm. Anything else you do, big thing that you've been doing for a while?
I'm also a member of National Charity League, which mm-hmm. is an organization where you do philanthropy around the community. I'm really involved at the SPCA, I like volunteering there a lot, mm-hmm. and I've been in that since seventh grade.
So is this a long time legitimate focus of your life, or is this a little fluff and resume builder for college?
It's actually, I've been doing it for a while, and we meet every month, and it's really fun, and you get to be with a lot of kids your age and just help out around the community.
Yeah, so. Good. So it's a part of your life then.
Yeah.
And I don't mean to be cruel to you, I know that's pretty abrupt, but you know, I think that these professionals are pretty good at detecting what's mm-hmm. surface level and what's some depth in, mm-hmm. and really doesn't matter what she does it?
I agree. It's whatever your passion is. Mm-hmm. And we're able to identify when a student is has a true passion, mm-hmm. and when a student is just doing things to get on her resume.
What if she sends in next year, she spends 4 hours a week on about 20 different things? What's your reaction going to be?
Not a good thing, because we don't see commitment, mm-hmm. and the passion, we can't see the passion at all.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, seems like you've got that part, being the person side, pretty squared away. You've got mm-hmm. that real, you know, built up well. It's a big part of your life. Mm-hmm. How about academics? What kind of student are you?
I focus a lot on academics. I try also to balance myself. Like I said, I play 3 varsity sports in sophomore year, so I try not to only focus on academics. Mm-hmm. I also like running, getting around outside after school and playing on a team and having that teammate component to it also.
What's your favorite sport?
I think lacrosse, actually. It didn't used to be, but it's really growing on me, and it's becoming so much more popular around the country and the West Coast, too.
I'd like to mix it up a little bit.
Yeah, it's really fun.
Yeah, good. Anything else that you do in your life that we missed?
I think that's about it right now, yeah.
Okay, academically, you know, kids don't like to talk about themselves, but what kind of student are you? What kind of grades do you get?
I have around A-, B+.
Okay, so have some honors AP classes?
I'm in honors Spanish this year, and next year I plan to be in honors Latin and Spanish, mm-hmm. and then probably taking an AP Science too next
year. Okay, do you have a feel for what kind of test taker you are?
I'd say for me, my GPA is stronger than my SAT scores right now. Mm-hmm. I plan to take a prep course sometime soon, okay. so that'll hopefully help. But
and did you take the SAT last week?
I didn't, but I'm signed up for the ACT actually in next month, and then the SAT I'm going to take in May.
Good, and we'll come back to that a little bit later. I want to focus on that as well. Okay, Dad, how about you? What do you think about this young lady?
Well, I'm very proud of her, obviously. She's a very balanced young lady, and that's the thing I'm most proud of. You know, she's tried a bunch of different things in her life, and I think this is a good time in a child's life to experiment with different aspects of things that might fuel their interest. You know, so she has been playing sports for several years, and I've been involved in some of that, doing some coaching, and now as a fan on the sidelines. Mm-hmm. And I just enjoy watching kids develop, and I think she's I'm proud of her.
You're not one of those helicopter parents, then.
Well, I think if you'd ask me, I'd say no. If you'd ask me, you might say, well, you know, I hear those propeller blades every once in a while.
Well, I suspect you're not one of those attack helicopter parents, the Blackhawks, but there's that fine line between showing love and interest and then also controlling and so forth. Mm-hmm. You have to sort of hover in the background.
It's tough to hold back. Mm-hmm. You know, I do force myself to back off a little bit. Yeah. Once in a while, just to make sure that she's having the independent experiences that she needs. And that's why I think something like the college trips that she's been on through Stevenson have been really helpful, because, you know, I obviously haven't been there, and she's out with her friends and kind of learning how to get around in the world. On this last trip, She and some of her friends were riding the T in Boston, all over town, going from one school to another.
I think we'll see a picture later about her doing that.
So
I guess my point is for the parents out here, because it's a big issue with me. I see it every year, and I deal with absolutely hands off. I don't really care what's happening with my kid. That's your job. You take care of it. To the helicopter parent who totally controls the application and the kid just gives up. And I'm sure you see that as well and you can detect that. So what sort of advice is a parent who's both in our community, as a parent, as a teacher, you know, as a sometime coach, you're just an interested party, what advice can you give to parents about the proper role?
Think of yourself as a coach. You know, a lot of people have been involved in sports and they know what the role of a good coach is, and it's not to play the game. It's to teach the skills and to encourage at the right time and to motivate at the right time and to try to answer questions and at the right time, but it's not to play the game, and that's the way I approach it.
Yeah, I think I love that metaphor. Yeah. It's a great thing. I have a contract that I use with the families, and I think most of our counselors do, that it stipulates my job, your job, and the student's job, and it's, you know, it's not officially binding, but it's to set forth the rules and regulations, what everybody should expect to do, and to know our place, and we each have three different roles. And, you know, sometimes it comes to the fact their mom and dad, you know, are in conflict with the son or daughter, and when that occurs, unless the kid is absolutely off the wall and, you know, totally recalcitrant, wrong, in the wrong place, you know, we will side with the student. You know, we tell parents that right up front, because you and I have gone to school and it's, you know, it's her time, her turn. But I think that's what the colleges want too. You want them to own the process, right?
And we actually want them to go through the process, even though that's not the case most of the time. Usually the parents are the ones calling, but we do want to see the students take their initiative.
Like, you don't want me to call for her either.
I want you to call.
Now, will it ever get to the point where we could hurt her, or too much parent meddling, I'm too much of an advocate, where that turns you off?
It's on a case-by-case scenario. It really depends. If a student really needs that support, we see it. But for the most part, it is a turnoff. It is something that we don't encourage parents or counselors to do. We want to hear the students, and we want to see the students are interested in.
Good. Well, let's turn to Monticello now. We've met you two. What can you tell us about yourself?
Well, I've been working at Santa Clara University a little bit over 6 years, originally from Salinas. And what I do at Santa Clara is I oversee international recruitment, transfer recruitment, and also work with freshmen.
And you're from Salinas, right?
Yes.
Used to work here. In fact, Maricela and I know some people in common. So, and you were where before you came to Santa Clara?
What do you mean where?
I thought you were like at Cal State or LSL or someplace. Well, I knew you before Santa Clara.
I was at LSL, MCOE, and then Santa Clara.
Okay, well, that's because we crossed paths several times before. But you've been to Santa Clara for a while.
I have been for a while.
And it's sort of nice in our process where my side of the desk gets to know their side of the desk, and I don't hesitate to call her, and she doesn't hesitate to get really upfront and realistic with me, like our conversation
last
week.
Honest.
She said, "Geez, Dave, we don't have the real strong applications from your school like
it's
we normally have."
And I
cut me to the quick, but
I'm
I like that honesty, and that helps us. And when I tell you and I call you up and I say, "Hey, listen, maybe we didn't represent this kid well, but this kid's a star," you know, hopefully you're gonna, you know.
We consider that.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Before we get started, any just opening salvos, anything you want to share with us about your job and your role? And
My role is essentially to help students through the application process. I know sometimes, well, most of the time, the application process is overwhelming. The fact that there's so many systems with the privates, the UCs, CSUs, and now with the economy. Just helping the students through the process.
Reading, you're deciding.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. Like this is where the buck stops for Santa Clara. Okay. Well, let's get started, and we're gonna give you a chance to relax a little bit, and we want to talk about our trip. But feel free to comment on anything or clarify some things. Our goal is to help people understand about this trip. Just to reconfirm what this is, we take two of these tours. And why do we do this? You know, why did we do that to Southern California? Why did we go back east?
I think it's good, just not necessarily that you're gonna find the right college on the tour, but to just get the experience to see so many different colleges and see all the differences, big, small, like in a city, in a small town, and just to be like open and to noticing all the differences in life.
So you're just trying to sort things out
and
know things you couldn't possibly know.
Yeah.
I mean, we've been around for a while, we've been on campuses, we've had several experiences, maybe grad school, and we're assuming you know nothing. And we're just trying to fill up the beaker and give you some choices. Okay, Dad, why do parents invest that kind of money for those sorts of fun, freedom type things?
Well, I think there are a couple of reasons that I felt. One is to give her that exposure in a short amount of time to a number of different schools. And I think the categories that Elisa just mentioned of large school, small school, you know, city school, country school, there's several other dimensions. It's good to be able to see a number of schools back to back so you can make those comparisons even in the same day in some situations. Mm-hmm. And you know, the other thing is, I think it's a first step toward independence. After someone's been living at home for most of their life for 15, 16, 17 years, this is a chance to begin that process of breaking away. And I think it's very valuable for that. Mm-hmm.
I like that term. In fact, I do a workshop late in the year for the seniors. It's called Letting Go and Breaking Away. Your job is to break away. Your job is to let go. Yeah. And I try to give you some tips and a formula for doing that. Okay, a lot of time, a lot of money. We do put a great deal into preparing for this. In your end, what is the student preparation for this trip?
I know that I had brought a journal with me the entire time, and I was taking notes on all the schools and just preparing to, you're going to see all these different schools and just be prepared. Some of them are going to be seem perfect, some of them are going to seem like you would never want to go there, but just be open to seeing all the different schools.
Mm-hmm. Logistically, what do you have to do to prepare? I mean, we help you with that. We give you guidelines. We have two big meetings. We give you mm-hmm. lists and their check-off things and contracts and financial mm-hmm. arrangements. But logistically, what else do you do?
Just prepare yourself, like be ready to see different colleges and just know that this is like one of the steps toward going to college, and there's so many steps, and this is just one of the first ones. And at first it does seem overwhelming to know that you're going to be seeing over 20 colleges in 9 days or more, and just to know that it's just one more step being closer to finding the perfect one.
Plus you got to be wearing some clothes back there that we don't wear here.
Yeah.
What it went from 6 degrees right down to 9
degrees.
Definitely
had to buy some new coats for these coats that I would not use in Monterey.
It's interesting seeing some of these California kids show up in flip-flops on the plane.
Yeah.
And then they're getting off into a foot of snow.
It's kind of shocking.
How about the families? What do the families have to do to get ready? Anything getting your mind right about this? Or?
Well, you know, for me, the biggest decision, I made an important transition, I think, during her last trip. And whereas before, maybe a couple months ago, I was really hoping, kind of, you know, in the background, that she would pick a school in California or somewhere on the West Coast.
Yeah.
But hearing her excitement that she expressed in her messages and her phone couple of phone conversations and some text messages about how much fun she was having, and I told her this in the conversation after we got back, that I kind of flipped, and now I almost want her to sort of take off and fly as far as she wants to have the experience and the independence that she feels like she needs. So
yeah.
I made a major switch in the past couple weeks in that way.
The mind always works best when open. we were anticipating down the road, we were being a little Machiavellian with our kids, and we wanted them to go back east for undergraduate, because then we could say, come back to California for grad school, because we wanted them nearby. Mm-hmm. Of course, they did just the opposite. They went here and they went grad school elsewhere. You tend to stay where you finish grad school in many cases. Mm-hmm. At any rate, moving to that, we talked about preparation a little bit. Moving to the next one, rules and expectations. Obviously, you're taking 57 people, 63 total, big enterprise. You got to have some control of stuff. Were you aware of your constrictions, the rules, the expectations for you?
Yeah, definitely aware. I mean, it is a school trip, so I treated it like I was just at school, but we were on the East Coast. And everyone knows this is planning for our future, and it'd be a shame to do something that would stop that, like while you're on a college tour. And everyone obviously behaved themselves. And
yeah, this junior class has been wonderful, both trips, the Southern California trip and the back to East trip. But truth be told, in past years, we've had an occasional kid get misstep and, you know, get involved with things they can't, and it's affected their ability to graduate from our school. It also has an impact on college.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you wouldn't be worried about your daughter with this, but do you think parents have a reason to be concerned about things like this much freedom?
Well, you know, you're always concerned as a parent about having too much or too little freedom. I mean, there's so many balance points that you try to reach as a parent. And I felt very comfortable because I knew you and I knew some of the other counselors that were going on the trip. And I knew that it was kind of a nice combination of structure and openness and freedom. And, you know, that independence comes in steps as somebody grows up. And we've always talked about how you earn your right to the next step of independence by how you behave now. Mm-hmm. And you know, as kids grow up, they just earn that right to be more and more on their own.
Yeah.
They earn the respect.
Well, I want to move to the next topic just ever so briefly, because it's going to vary according to group, you know, the groups that come. But I want to talk about finances. And I put a little slide on each one so you can sort of see, get a feel for, this is a lecture format at one of the schools we visited, but a lecture auditorium. But finances are going to vary. If you take a little Northern California trip just on the weekend, you can see Santa Clara and Stanford and Cal and so forth. You can do that fairly cheaply. No motel rooms, no whatever. But if you go back east, obviously you've got a flight to worry about. Sometimes you have to, you know, be concerned with paying the supervisors, you know, renting a car. So this can be very expensive. $2,000 or whatever. Now, if you amortize that over, you know, a $200,000 education, it's pretty minimal. But for most people in our audience, I guess our goal is not to intimidate you. I guess it's to take away the intimidation, to raise the expectation that you can do this. I mean, you can't do this. Everybody can't do this kind of trip. And maybe parents can't take off, you know, from their job for a week or whatever. But you can do something. You can get on a campus. And I think the schools love that. You know, they encourage that. They'll sometimes buy you lunch. I mean, they're coming to you. Muhammad's coming to the mountain here, and they like to see that. And we've always found it, even on a budget trip, you can make it happen. So don't let the finances dissuade you from doing this. You can do it at some level. Okay, the personnel, I think that's important. You can do this in a variety of ways. You can go on a commercial trip that costs lots of money, and you pay people that maybe don't know much other than being tour guides. You can go with a school group with maybe some personnel. We got pictures of two of our chaperones here who are very highly qualified. They've been around and they know what they're doing, and you know, they shepherd you. They provide lots of information. Did you feel an impact of the adults with you? Like, were we there enough, too much? Did it matter that we were there?
I think it was good. Like, we had, my favorite was when we were in Boston and you guys let us just go free in the city and look at all the schools we wanted. But then there were times when it was nice to have you guys there if we had questions and to be on the tour, to turn and ask, like, mm-hmm. if I wanted to ask you a question about the school.
And that's sort of also the middle ground between having your parents there too. We sort mm-hmm. of act in loco parentis, but we're not your parents.
Exactly.
And you want to do some things that you don't want to be around your parents.
Yeah.
So you have to find the right mix of things that works for you. Maybe it can be a family vacation. Maybe it can be a school group. Maybe it's just a couple of, you know, your buddies on the weekend. If you're driving, mm-hmm. you can go up the Bay Area. But get out there and do something. Get active, get involved, get your feet on a campus. And then talk about it with other people. Transportation, obviously, we flew back to Washington. We had to fly home. We were on a bus. We used vans and cars, and it gave us lots of flexibility. We broke into different groups. We were highly structured, but that's part of the adventure, part of what you're learning, because everybody can't be on a team, and teams tend to tour like that. So I think this is part of, you know, it's grist for the mill. It's all a learning experience. And then staying. How would you characterize where we stay, the types of places?
It was nice.
Pretty
nice. It was
fun,
yeah. And also just being in a room with three of my best friends for 9 days was just really nice, too.
And that gets the cost down. You put three or four people in a room, mm-hmm. and that gets the cost down to, you know, a reasonable amount of money. But it's still a fairly stiff ticket for mom and dad to pay. But, and that's something you have to have a family conversation about. And, you know, are the fee covered just about everything except what you had to do yourself? And what could you get by with for 9 days? How much money did you spend?
I spent around $150 on meals, probably.
Yeah.
Buy a couple sweatshirts. So, I mean, you don't need too much, but...
Yeah, not too bad. And we stayed in pretty nice places, and we did it the right way, and mm-hmm. we were safe. You know, kids were in the subway once in a while. Kids took some buses and taxis mm-hmm. once in a while. But it's part of growing up. It's sort of a big thing.
Yeah.
Not sure I'd do it with sophomores or ninth graders, but, you know, juniors are, you know, a pretty good group to do that with. Okay, looking at our itinerary, how would you give a sort of a capsule, nutshell of what we did?
So we'd probably see around 3 schools a day. Wake up, go in the morning. Sometimes we get to have lunch at a school, which is kind of nice. I remember one time we stopped at a school and you got to eat in the cafeteria and kind of like pretend for a lunch period that you went there and kind of see how it felt and stuff. And so we'd drive in between the day, so it didn't make it too hard, even though we were going all along the East Coast, but we'd break it up in sections. So
watch the movies in between.
Yeah, we watched the movies.
Sometimes I forced a little TV or a college tape on.
Yep.
You know, jam that pen down your throat or
carpet
or whatever it was. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's pretty fun in some spots, not mm-hmm. boring. You're learning, but you're having fun, and it's a pretty good deal.
Yeah.
We started in Washington, ended up in Boston for 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
Little side trip down to Brown in Rhode Island. Little group went up to Maine and saw the three little Maine schools.
Mm-hmm.
30-odd schools you had to choose from. How many do you think you got on to see yourself?
probably around 20, 25.
Yeah, that's
it was a lot, but
bang, bang, bang.
Yeah, it was, but it was good. I'm glad I got to see that many, because to go all the way to the East Coast, and there's so many schools there.
Yeah, pretty typical. We'd get up in the morning, we'd go see a place, information session, tour, move on to the next place, mm-hmm. So it's bang, 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 and then hopefully you're writing in your journal and have it all make sense at the end. Mm-hmm. Choices, you had to make some choices. I get a slide up here. You either get to go to Brown or you see Tufts.
Yeah.
You know, it's a tough decision sometimes. Yeah. How did you make your decisions?
A lot of them, some of the schools I hadn't heard of before when we got the sheet to decide, and so I'd look them up on the internet. Of course, that's not as good as actually seeing it, but I kind of picked some schools that seemed like they'd fit me most better than the other ones, mm-hmm. and I was actually happy. I went on one of the trips, we split in half, and the trip I went on, I felt like I liked at least like 3 out of 5 of the schools.
Were you on that little van trip back to Williams and that group or not?
No, I was one with Tufts and Fairfield.
Oh, you were with me.
That's I was with you. And I was really glad I picked that, because I really connected with a lot of schools.
So. What was your big surprise school that you really liked you didn't think about liking?
I really actually liked NYU, surprisingly, because I had been to New York once when I was 7 and hadn't really liked it that much, thought it was just really big and kind of scary, and it was kind of nice going back and seeing it, and now that I'm older and seeing that it wasn't as scary as I had thought it was when I was 7. Yeah. And NYU was just a beautiful campus. And
I use these trips sort of personally. I had not been to Fairfield before. Mm-hmm. I hadn't been to Wesleyan for a long time, so it was nice getting reconnected there. And I'd never been to UConn.
Yeah.
UConn's a great,
that was one, another one of the, that was
gonna,
one of my favorites.
We're going to keep that on the trip. UConn's mm-hmm. a wonderful place. On the sticks, but a big deal, really neat. Okay, let's look at a typical day. I think we sort of talked about that. You get up and you bang, bang, you go around mm-hmm. a lot of places, and it's just one after the other. Yeah. Until you get to Boston, you're sort of free.
Yeah.
You know, we ask you to be in pairs, but you exercise lots of choices, mm-hmm. and some people waste their time. I'm sure you didn't. I'm sure you were pretty efficient with what you were doing. We also, a key thing is, and again, this is for our audience, if you can anticipate to meet alumni, like if you go locally, tons of alumni up at Santa Clara, some at Stanford, some at Cal, and hook up with them so you can get the real word from, you know, the good, bad, and the ugly from people who are really there. And we, of course, we planned that all beforehand, and in fact, you can see a picture of two of our alumni here up at Penn. And then we went to this little John Harvard Brew House up at Cambridge Square, and we met with like 20 of our alumni from the whole Boston area. And that's a really neat chance for you guys to sit down and talk with people and talk turkey and see what it's really like. Did you know any of the alumni that we met along the way?
I knew of like Bartel, known, and one of them, Loka, was actually my community forum leader when I was a freshman. Mm-hmm. So that was fun. And I didn't get to go to the dinner with the alumni, but a couple of my friends went and they said it was...
Yeah, so many people wanted to go, we had to do a little drawing.
Yeah.
37 kids that said they wanted to go. The next thing I wanted to talk about, and this didn't touch with you, but usually there are 3 or 4 athletes that want to meet with coaches, Division 1, 2, or 3, and we orchestrate that beforehand because it's, you know, you got to be on a pretty tight budget of time, and they have to miss the tour, the information session, but they get to spend quality time with a coach, and it really incites the recruiting process. And I've got a picture here at Lehigh, but we had tennis people and golf players mm-hmm. and occasionally football players. Really an efficient use of your time, and it really matters when you see what it's like and they get to see you, and of course mm-hmm. you create DVDs and records and so forth. Yeah. So it's a thing you can't miss doing. We do have paperwork. We provided you with a journal, a little preview mm-hmm. of each place. We wanted you to read about it. And then we also gave these scattergrams. Can you explain what those are?
Yeah, the scattergram, I think it's probably one of the most useful things to look at because it shows the people from Stevenson, their GPA, and their SAT scores. And so it's not just like an average GPA from all the people applying. It's people just like you from Stevenson. And it shows you with a little circle where you fit into that if you look at it on the Naviance site. So I actually look at those a lot, and it's just a better way. It's more close to home because you see people just like you, and if they got in and if they didn't. And
yeah, and we have, you probably looked at the NYU ones because mm-hmm. you liked NYU. Santa Clara has always been in our top 5, and in the last 5 or 6 years we keep those scattergrams. You can see everybody who applied and who got in, who didn't, and you really see yourself. And mm-hmm. I'm sure you could mimic that, you know what that's like, mm-hmm. and you could see it, but it's neat for our kids to be able to see, hey, I can really go there.
Yeah.
I can, mm-hmm. or hey, yeah. I better adjust myself to go to that place. And it also keeps me from having to deliver the bad news.
Yeah.
Okay, to put a little cap on this, what was the best thing about this tour for you? Either the Southern California tour or this, both of them together?
I really think when we got to Boston and we got to be on our own, That was probably my favorite part, because we got to see colleges, we got to walk around the city, see what it's like, and I really fell in love with Boston when we got there.
More so than New York.
Actually, yeah, I had never been to Boston before, and I kind of want a big city because I've gone to small school my whole life, and I think Boston's a perfect size because it's not as huge as New York, but it's still a big city. And Boston College I really liked, and
great
Boston
place.
University, but yeah, I just really enjoyed taking the tea everywhere and just getting the feel for what the city was like.
Yeah, sort of like being a freshman, you know, on your own, yeah. Boston's my favorite city, so I really like going back there, and I've been there year after year after year, and I still love it. It's a nice walkable city, lots of things. Now, BC, a lot of our kids love BC, and that's sort of a sister school to you, isn't it?
Claire, yeah, it's a Jesuit school.
Do you get many cross applications with BC?
We do, we do.
They're a little bit bigger. You know, in a city, East Coast, obviously, but you do get some crosses.
It's changing. Before, it was we would receive cross applications from BC and Santa Clara, but now it's changing. Now we're getting several students that apply to BC are
also
applying to Santa
Clara. Good. Okay, Dad, let's give you that final thing. What's the best thing about the tour that you saw?
I just saw her come back full of enthusiasm, and she was standing a little taller. And, you know, I think that says a lot.
Yeah. Still listening to you, though?
Well, you know, we have to make that transition from listening to me all the time to not listening to me at all.
Exactly. Last question for you here. We're always trying to make this thing better. I think it's fine-tuned like a Swiss watch, but if you were going to change this, what would you change about the trip? How should we make this better?
One thing I noticed was I think if we had spent more time in New York, this is just personally, I would have liked to see more of the city. I know we were there on a day when there was a big blizzard and a ton of snow, so I understand why we couldn't stay there longer, but I think it'd be fun just even spend a day there like we did in Boston. I thought that was really great to see the city, so if we could do that.
The reason we don't is because New York is crazy.
Yeah.
And drives me crazy. I like being there for little doses, but it's also very, very expensive.
Yeah.
We used to stay there years ago in the city, really expensive.
Mm-hmm.
Kids love New York.
Yeah.
I understand that. How about what should we change? You know a little bit about the trip now.
Well, I don't know. I thought it kind of hit the sweet spot pretty well. You know, in some ways you kind of would like to extend a little longer to see a few more schools that you had to cut off your list.
Yeah.
But there comes a saturation point, I think, where you know you've been on 15 tours or 20 tours, you know, and to add 5 or 6 more to it would probably not be productive. And if the goal is not to identify a specific school, but to really kind of decide, do you want a city, do you want a small town, do you want a big school, small school, those kind of decisions can be made almost no matter where you go. And I think your point about taking local trips in the Bay Area, you know, to Palo Alto or to San Francisco or to Santa Clara, you can start making those decisions independent of the specific schools. And then if you decide you like a small, intimate environment in a small town, then you can start doing some research and identify some of those schools in other parts of the country and then pinpoint the ones that you want to see.
Well, one of the changes that I put into the trip recently was we added Fairfield, which I know is a sister school, and I wanted kids to see a Santa Clara that's back east. And Fairfield is very much like Santa Clara.
I haven't been there.
It's a Jesuit school. It reminds me, I went there for the first time and I said, holy cow, I was right. This is Santa Clara. So if kids like Santa Clara, and I think they should like Fairfield, what do we like about those kind of schools? Give us a thumbnail sketch. Let's move on to the next section now, the other half. Tell us about Santa Clara.
Santa Clara is a medium-sized school. And it's in the middle of Silicon Valley. We're a Jesuit school. Mm-hmm. It was the first university in the state of California. And we have 3 academic divisions. We have the College of Arts and Sciences, Business, and Engineering. And we're known as a comprehensive school, meaning that we have the liberal arts foundation with professional schools.
And they always are on these U.S. News World Report, you know, scales. It's either Trinity or Santa Clara is the number one regional master's degree granting comprehensive university. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? What's all that gobbledygook mean?
It means that it has a strong liberal arts education with strong business schools.
And you've got engineering there, business school. You can get a master's degree, no PhD.
PhD in engineering. We have a very small program.
Very few people doing that.
Yeah.
And it's just the right place for certain types of people. D1 sports.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about this strong Jesuit, like, you know, do I have to be this devout Catholic to go there?
No, not necessarily. 50% of our students are non-Catholic, but Santa Clara does foster that community to help students from different backgrounds to feel connected to the community. the Jesuit influence is more of empowering students to become strong leaders in the community and to really live and breathe social justice.
And that's a big part of the application. Like, if you apply to LMU, Gonzaga, these type of schools, you better have some
Boston
component
College.
Like that, Boston College, because it matters to them. NYU, maybe not. A little different situation. Okay, we sort of know what some of the strengths are of that place. You know, obviously we're passionate about it. It's a great place. What are some of the limitations? What am I going to give up going to Santa Clara?
One is the size. Given that we have 5,000 undergraduate students, if students are looking for larger classrooms to be in the middle of a city, obviously they're not going to find that at Santa Clara.
I'm applying to Santa Clara. Where else do you usually find kids applying? What are your cross apps?
Our cross applications are with Boston College, USD.
That's
Gonzaga,
University of San Diego.
University
down south.
Of San Diego, yes. Gonzaga.
Up
in Washington. University of San Francisco. Trinity. So other.
Trinity in Texas. Do you think that's because of the magazine that brought you together? People
I
see one and the
know,
other.
Maybe.
I bet you it is. Yeah.
Maybe, and other Jesuit schools as well.
Okay.
It's usually the Jesuit influence.
Anything with Stanford going on there?
Not really. It's more the Jesuit schools.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Good. How about, like, I've always thought of them as you get the big time athletics, but you get the little liberal arts focus too. I mean, they did Red Wave football years ago, but. Mm-hmm. Soccer's still pretty big. Basketball's big. Mm-hmm. You get that flavor of big-time sports, don't you?
You do. I mean, Division I sports are strong, and you mentioned the soccer and basketball are really
and you
strong.
You got hockey in the Bay Area and all that stuff, too.
And then we also have a very active intramural sports. Mm-hmm. Literally, if a student wins one of the games, or they become like superstars on campus.
Yeah.
So they have a strong sports program.
What would you say is the big co-curricular draw? That like we associate certain things with certain schools. What should we associate with Santa Clara?
That's a really good question. I think it would be the Jesuit influence and community service.
Because outreach, the service, all this stuff.
Community service.
Yeah, good. Mm-hmm. That's what I would think, too, yes. Okay, we talked about the cross apps. Give us some hard numbers. What does it take to get in there? I mean, obviously there's a spectrum, but generally, and I can tell you what our averages are getting in there, but what does it take to go to Santa Clara? Where can I feel confident?
When we look at applications, and if you just look at the hard numbers, the average GPA of students that were admitted last year is a 3.6 unweighted. So we'll take the GPA from freshman to junior year. SAT scores typically are between a 1230 and 1300 without the writing component.
And you don't care about that third score yet?
Okay. Not yet. Not at this
What point. If it's really, really strong? Like, our school has strong writing scores.
Not
you
at
pay
this
any attention
time.
To that?
Mm-mm.
Come on, you got to give it some break.
No, not at this time. We have to be fair with everyone.
You're absolutely correct.
So those are the numbers, but then there's also the personal. So you mentioned earlier about Naviance and the numbers. We do look at grades, and academics are literally the strongest point on your application. However, the personal could really influence a decision. And that could be if a student is really involved in the community or anything else in their personal life that affected their grades, and that's also considered. So we really try to do a holistic evaluation on the application.
Okay, good. Hard job, isn't it?
Very tough,
how many kids do you have to say no to for every kid you say yes to?
Well, the numbers for this year were a little bit under 11,000, and we admitted approximately 5,000 students.
And that's to get how many coming in?
1,200.
So you admit 5,000, you get 1,200. Mm-hmm. So your yield is what?
25%.
That's about the same as Cal and UCLA and those hot schools, so that's pretty good. That's really down from, I remember when it was 40%.
It's when tough. I started at Santa Clara, we were at 6,000 applications, 5,000 applications, and admitting high number, and now it's doubled.
Well, let's look at our next slide here. You know, and these are, you know, just to tip the definition, or just the broad topics we're going to talk about. Plus, we've got a little picture of
Benson
things on
Center.
Campus. that's home for you there. So tell us from your side of the desk, what are some ways that our students can have a little edge, a little tip in terms of you selecting them? This whole selection process, what's going to give kids an edge?
In regards to
getting
the
in?
Application,
yeah.
just overall? Well, it depends on where you're at in the application process. So if you're a freshman, sophomore, trying to figure out if Santa Clara is a good fit, it's obviously visit, but also make sure that you're taking care of your grades, make sure that you're taking care of the classes that you need to take, and also get involved. find your passion. I know before we started this, we were talking about passion, and really we want students to devote time to what their true passion is, what their calling in life is. And the way that they find their passion is by exploring. So freshman, sophomore year, they'll have an opportunity to explore. Junior year, senior year, they really go forward and work in that area.
When do I start?
The application process?
No, that's the application process. That's the tail end. That's the icing on the cake. When do I start this whole process of deciding what am I doing with my future?
When students are ready. But usually the best time to start, I would say, the end of sophomore year, or even sophomore year, because they have to make sure that they've taken the courses. Every school may require certain courses in order for admission.
Junior might be too late then.
Junior year might be too late.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Good.
But they do have to start sophomore year. If they start junior year, they still have some time to make sure that they take the classes and be able to do well that junior
year. Best thing is always listen to your counselor.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
If not your parents.
Or the admission counselor.
Yeah. Okay, how about, like, we've been visiting lots of schools, and you know, we bring kids up to visit you. What's the best tip you can give for visiting colleges? How can they get the most out of that?
The best advice that I could give them is essentially for them to take a moment by themselves and to really feel the campus, to see if they could see themselves at the campus, because if they don't, then it's not a good fit. Talk to the students there. Obviously when you go to the admission office, everybody's going to be positive about the university, but take that time to go to the cafeteria, ask questions, and really get a feel for the campus, and stop someone and say, pretend that you're lost, because then that's going to tell you if students are friendly or if they're not, and what type of environment in the school really has.
Yeah, I always say find out the good, the bad, and the ugly. You know, sit down and talk with people who grouse and they don't like it, and you know, want to find everything, because it's not wonderful for everybody for all time.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
And that's sometimes a tough thing to do. Okay, if I can't get to Santa Clara or elsewhere, you come to us. I mean,
correct.
You're here pretty much every year. In fact, sometimes you do interviews and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the best advice for our juniors and seniors for when you come?
Other than taking me Starbucks?
Yeah.
essentially just to talk to you, find out when I'm coming to campus. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we're also at fair, so we're at the Carmel High Fair and then also the Hartnell Fair. So it's essentially just meet with you and find out when
and, and if I find out about Santa Clara, I've essentially also found out a little bit about Gonzaga and USF and LMU and so forth. Mm-hmm. So our advice is see types of schools. Did you visit any reps this year? In the fall?
I did not yet, no.
Next year you're going to do that.
Yeah.
Probably
I'm
75
your first
will
one.
Come.
Yeah.
And you want to see, NYU doesn't come, a lot of those places are just too far, but the local people come and representative types come, and that's what you got to try to see. And come with your questions and get your impression in her mind. Like, she's got 8 or 10 people in our school, another school, another school, hundreds of kids she sees. How is she going to remember Alisa? Okay, that's what you got to do. So however you can do that. Okay, let's talk about standardized tests a little bit. And this is, I jump right past it here, standardized tests. I hate these things, but we got to do them. What role do they play at Santa Clara?
They're obviously part of the application process.
Hope you got to jump through.
Yeah, and we have to take, and we take, like we mentioned, the critical reading and the math. And then for the ACT, we also consider that.
What if I'm a superstar? I'm a hard worker, I get good grades, you've got the whole package, you know, I really belong at Santa Clara, I just can't crack 1200.
We consider that in the application because the transcript is literally the foundation of your application. If we see a student that has done great at Stevenson and they've taken strong curriculum, and for some reason they can't get the highest SAT score or break the 1200, that is considered because we do consider the rigor and the coursework as part of that evaluation.
And no SAT twos.
No SAT twos.
How about the ACT? She's going to take that first.
We do consider that.
But how do you prefer either one?
No, we don't prefer. Yeah. We actually do a conversion. So for the critical reading, it's the English and the reading, and then for the math, it's the math. And so we have.
I think our kids do slightly better on the average with the ACT.
Usually, most students do better on the ACT.
Why don't we get rid of the SAT and just do it?
No comment. <Yeah.
laughs> Okay, let's jump to the essay. What role does the essay play at Santa Clara? And tell us about some really good essays you've read.
The essay is the soul. So we talked about the foundation of your application is your transcript. So I would say the essay is the soul of the application because that's the only way students have an opportunity to showcase themselves. Mm-hmm. I always advise students to look at two pictures, freshman year picture to senior year picture. Mm-hmm. Create a list and so forth to really find that person or that event or anything that really changed you and then to talk about it. Yeah. But it could really, like I mentioned earlier, change a decision in
all things equal,
process.
She's got a great essay, he doesn't. She gets in.
It doesn't come down to that, but essay does have a strong influence.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a way to put some skeleton or some meat on the skeleton. Yeah.
The soul.
Tell me, that's better, the soul, especially at Santa Clara.
Yeah.
Tell me in your mind a good one that just tickled your fancy, you shared with somebody.
Oh gosh, it varies.
Any recent ones you've read that are really good?
Well, right now I have a ton in my head. The best one, immersion trips are really tricky. There's a lot of students that go to Latin America and they do immersion trips, and that's probably the number one topic that students choose. However, those could be the best essays because students come back and they do something at their high school, something in their community, or sometimes it could just be just the essay and we really don't see anything there. There's a lot, but I would say immersion trips are really powerful because we do see a lot of students coming back and
I always warn kids they've got to be very cautious, circumspect about being hackneyed, trite, and writing the typical, I went to Mexico and built churches.
Yes.
You know, if you listen to every kid, they're wall-to-wall churches in Mexico with no walking space. And you've got to ferret your way through to find out what's real and what's not real. That's got to be a tough job, but I'm sure you're good at it by now.
We're really good at it because then if we see the essay and we go to extracurricular activities and we don't see anything, then that's usually.
So I guess if I can use the term, you're a crap detector. You've got to find the authentic truth about stuff.
Exactly. I think so. You're absolutely right.
You get that meter going. And
some parents actually compare us to the FBI.
Yeah, exactly.
They're like, you have to. We do a lot of research and like you know, we call you to see if we ever need information, we always call you to find out more details.
And that's where we really feel we can be helpful. Mm-hmm. Okay, what's a piece of advice? What should they avoid in this application process? What's a big no-no, a big boo-boo?
In regards to the application process?
On your application,
Obviously, not being truthful. Yeah. There's been cases, not at Santa Clara, but just in the country that students have been caught or not following directions or applying early action to single choice early action to two schools that have that same policy.
Right.
So it's just making sure that you're being honest and that you're following all policies.
In fact, let's jump to that since you brought it. The early policy, there's early application, early acceptance, early decision one, early decision two, and then there's early action restricted single choice.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you fit in with that?
We have early action. No,
which means I apply, I get in, I don't have to go.
You don't have to come.
That's good. You should do that if you can.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's for the kids, for the students.
Mm-hmm. And then early decision is where you're admitted and then you're committed to the institution. We don't have both.
You
early action.
Do good, wonderful.
Just early action.
Catholics, Jesuits. Now, there's people that play the game, and I'm not Catholic, but people play the game. Stanford, MIT did, Harvard. Yale
most
have an early action restricted. That means if you apply to one EA school, you can't apply to other ones.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how does Santa Clara react to that?
In regards to their policy?
What, do you think that's fair?
That's their own policy.
No.
In regards to Santa Clara, we do accept applications early action if the student applies to another program.
Yeah.
But for those schools, they might have their reasons why they have the early action.
I don't like it, as you can see. I think it's sort of an unfair, and they do it because they can do it. And I think that puts kids over a barrel. And you know, as on my side of the desk, we don't like that. enough said. Anything else that's a no-no, like what you shouldn't write about the essay, maybe, or things to stay away from?
Well, the number one no-no I would recommend for students not to do is essentially not to write about themselves.
Yeah.
There's a lot of students in the essay that tend to write about somebody else rather than themselves, and that's a lost opportunity.
But you can do that in a way that really reflects on you.
If you're able to tie it back to you, then yes. If you are not able to
do that,
that's
tough.
It's tough. Yeah, it's tough if the essay is about somebody else and not the student.
Okay. Can I ask you a question? Is the purpose of the essay mainly to learn about the student?
Yes.
You mentioned the SOL rather than to assess their writing skills?
Well, it's a combination of both. It's a we do look at the essay, especially if the critical reading or the ACT is lower. However, for the personal evaluation, we do look at the meat and the content of the essay, because that's important. Because when you're trying to distinguish one student from another, it's very difficult to do so, and the essay is really handy and also extracurricular activities. Yeah.
Now, the UC system, less emphasis on the writing. They say that right up front, because of the they're trying to level the playing field, across the state, and their uneven high school experiences. They don't want to penalize kids, which is, which is good and appropriate. Okay, let's jump to the core of the matter here, why I've got you here. How does Santa Clara do it? You're the boss. You're the one who does it every day. Demystify this for us. How do you make a decision about people?
Well, the reality is in an application could take us 10 minutes to evaluate, even though it might take a student 2 months to put it together, or it could take us longer than that, maybe a day, or maybe it has to go through multiple evaluators. In our case, we have a system where we have the territory manager to be the first reader. If we're able to admit the student, we go ahead and admit the student. If we're not able to admit the student, then that goes into a committee, and then it becomes a discussion with the committee.
Okay, so you are the advocate for our kids?
Correct.
Okay, so you've got all of our 20, 30 applications. How many do we have this year?
I need to go back.
Lots.
Usually average is 40.
Now, do you pit our kids against each other, or are they against the pool?
First step is against each other.
Oh, that's bad.
It's against each other.
And probably us against York and Catalina and schools, or no?
Not necessarily, no.
Just
no,
us
no.
against?
Just against
So that's
each
a
other.
Truism. You're considered amongst, in the pool in which you swim with the other fish, right?
That's correct.
And I like that image. If you want to swim the sharks, you got to jump into that tank. And that's a pretty tough shark tank if you want to go to, BC and Notre Dame and Georgetown and Harvard and Yale. It's a different tank than LMU and Gonzaga and so forth. So that's all about getting the fit. So it's pretty brusque then. You're pitting us against each other. Then what do you do?
And then it goes to the larger group.
Yeah. What's the most important thing that matters to you? I know the answer, but I want to make sure that they know.
In regards to just
the hierarchy of importance, what do you look to first?
Well, obviously academics is the first.
As measured by what?
The grades, the rigor.
The transcript.
The
big T. Okay. How can I get a great transcript?
By working really hard and doing your homework.
Yeah, hard classes. Hard classes.
Listening to your counselor.
No. but she's heard the mantra plenty of times. Okay, then what are the next things in order that you'll look at?
So the first, like I mentioned, is the academics. So we'll look at the GPAs and
class rank, rigor, all this stuff that defines
and
the
transcript. And then the personal to complete a holistic evaluation. So we'll
we're looking at the academics and the person. And we've talked about the personal stuff. But within academics, the transcripts first. Where do standardized tests fit in there? Are they down here or are they next?
It's almost, I would say it's almost the same. It really depends on the application. There isn't, I can't just say it's like below. It's essentially a combination of both.
Okay. How about I'm in mathletics and I win that award, or I win essay contest, or I do a speech contest, or I'm a Westinghouse award winner, Intel award winner. All these are academic ways to measure. Do those matter? Do you take those into consideration?
We do consider them, because the students usually include that information in their common application or in their resume, and we do consider
How important
that.
Is what I tell you?
It's
my letters
important.
Are like, and our teacher letters, how important? What role do they play?
It's
are we wasting
important.
Our time?
You're not wasting your time, believe me, because at the end of the day, when we're going back and forth and looking at the application, we go to the letter of recommendation, and when I really need help, I go to you to find out if it's a good fit, and we essentially want to make sure that the student is going to do well at Santa Clara.
Okay.
That's always our concern.
Yeah. Do we have an unfair advantage? Like, I used to teach at Seaside High School, you know that, and you've been to that school, and Alisal and the schools over here. Big public schools can't do what we can do. So does that mitigate against public school kids? Does that give our kids an unfair advantage?
No,
or are they
not.
Just separate?
They're separate.
Yeah.
So what we do in the evaluation is that when we consider any type of application, we look at the type of high school that student is coming from, we'll look at the access they have to education, and we'll also look at the curriculum. So every school is very different. Every school is very different, and we consider that when evaluating the application.
Okay. So we've looked at each of these parts and the role they play. How about some schools will give a great deal of weight to a person's intention. Like, they visited Santa Clara, they wrote their application, they went on a tour, they saw it in the summertime, they went to your rep. Doesn't matter to you guys.
Not at Santa Clara.
Some people keep track of all those things.
We do keep track just to make sure to know the history of the student, but we don't.
So I throw in a common application at the last minute, and that matters the same as hers, and she's been there.
At Santa Clara at this point, that's
oh, wow, reality. That's interesting. Yeah. But if you know that occurs, that's a little edge you can use, the intention. Like I know Dickinson College, Pennsylvania, they track those things. It really matters to them. It's good to know. You need to
every
know
your... Every school is very different. Everything
mm-hmm. It's a little bit different. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you have a committee, and you're hot to trot. You're picking these five people at Stevenson you really want to push for, and you get up and you beat the band, you try to convince them. Are they going to buy it? Can you persuade the committee?
At some points we can. It really depends on the applicant pool.
But we're voting. Mm-hmm. Everybody votes, up or down, right?
Yes. Yes.
Interesting process. Yeah.
It is very interesting.
And of course, you get mad sometimes when people don't get
it. Of course, especially if they're from Stevenson.
Yeah, good. you've been other places. How does that vary with some other schools, the way they do it?
It really depends school by school. There are schools that just follow numbers. There are schools that are specifically recruiting a type of student. Mm-hmm. So it really depends on the school.
And you don't do a number system. Like I know a bunch of schools back east rate a candidate 1 to 5, 1 to 6.
No, not at all.
As a person and as an academic, you don't do that. Mm-mm. Yeah. Okay. Let's jump. We talked about EA a little bit. Let's jump over the financial aid because, that really doesn't matter for the application. You guys are need blind, right?
Correct.
Pretty much? Like,
correct.
Like the last two kids, they're equal. One can pay and one can't.
We don't
That's
look
not gonna,
at that.
Good
yeah.
for you. That's how you should be here. Mm-hmm. Okay, once I get in, and I think that it's between LMU and Santa Clara, how do I make that decision? How are you going to help me?
Financial aid? Financial aid is really important.
Yeah.
For every student, this is my personal opinion, is that a student should apply to any school that they see themselves at and wait until you get the financial award letter.
Yeah.
Because it is an investment, but you have to be smart about it.
She gets more money at LMU. She calls you up and really wants to go to Santa Clara. Are you guys going to do anything for her?
Santa Clara does not, it's not case by case, yeah. but we don't do a lot of bargaining.
Yeah.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, that's a
it really thing. Every school it has their own ways of doing things, but at the end of the day, you do have to apply for financial aid and see the financial aid packages and look at the options that you have and what type of careers you are interested in.
Okay, I've gotten in Santa Clara, decide I'm going to go. I'm okay with the financial aid package. What do I do in May? Tell me about May in the summertime. What do I got to do?
So in May, May 1st, you deposit, hopefully, to Santa Clara.
$200? $400?
Usually $200, $400. And during the summertime, there is orientation.
Good.
And students go to orientation. Some students actually want to prepare and can get a heads up on maybe taking a class here or there at the community college, or they take an opportunity to relax before they go into college or do some type of service.
Okay, good. Well, we've covered lots of ground here. I'm going to give you just a few seconds to give us your best piece of advice. Dad, student, admissions officer, what's the best thing you can tell our audience here?
The best advice is essentially enjoy this process, because if I were to go back to high school and have an opportunity to look at universities and look at college, is really take your time. You don't have to make a decision right now. Essentially, you're just exploring and finding that perfect place for you.
I would say really just try to, like you said, picture yourself there. And I definitely use my journal every day after each school. I'd write the pros and cons. And looking back at that, it's good to have that journal.
Dan?
I'd say the best thing a parent can do is to encourage investigation of several different schools, several different types of schools, and then to be a supporter but not the person who's doing all the work, because I think this is an important step for them to take the initiative to do the work themselves.
Good. Well, I think we've covered a lot of ground today. We've talked about the tour, the values of the tour, the ups and downs, everything that goes into it, logistics. We've talked about what it's really like about both Santa Clara and the process of behind the doors, what they do. We got it straight from the horse's mouth, the expert, the person who's been doing it for years, the professional. And I think we're on the right track. I think we know on our side of the desk what they're doing, and we're sort of partners. And our goal is to have you guys find the right place so everybody's happy. I want to thank you all three for coming and helping us out. I want to thank the parents and the students who are watching this show. And I want to invite you to see our next program in 2 weeks, where we're going to deal with the seniors. We're going to talk about, what do I do now that I've been waitlisted, I've been deferred, I've gotten in, or I've been denied? What's the next step for me? So I want to close with our motto, our sort of mantra that we use every program. Remember that it's never too early to start thinking about colleges, and it's not too late to get started, no matter how old you are. This is Dave Miller thanking you for joining us, inviting you to come next time. and wishing you good luck in your search for the right college for you.